I have two words for you. Predator drones. You will never see it coming. You think I'm joking?
Yes, our president has a hit list of American citizens like you targeted for assassination. Now, I want you to imagine George W. Bush had a hit list of Americans targeted for assassination. This president does, and there are indications that the list of Americans targeted for assassination is growing. The CIA's list included three people, apparently, just a few months ago, but in a recent interview with the Washington Times, President Obama and his top terrorism advisor, John Brennan, said there are dozens of U.S. citizens around the world that are, quote, very concerning to the administration. Brennan also making two distinctions about who would, quote, face the brunt of the U.S. military response. Group one, a U.S. citizen found on the battlefield in Afghanistan or Iraq attacking U.S. forces. That's makes sense. Group two, a U.S. citizen in Yemen or Pakistan or Somalia or some other place attacking U.S. forces. It is unclear, however, if the dozens Brennan mentioned are on that list. But as Salon.com's Glenn Greenwald puts it, Brennan's statement suggests that the president's battlefield powers extend everywhere, even to places where there is actually no combat whatsoever. And joining us now, Salon.com's Glenn Greenwald. Glenn, how do you interpret this? I won't even subject you to a bunch of questions. If you look at this, is this as bad as it appears?
It's probably worse than it appears. I mean, look at the controversies that were created during the Bush administration when the president got caught spying on American citizens without warrants or trying to detain them without due process. Here you're talking about something far more extreme. You're talking about targeting American citizens for murder, for assassination, based merely on the allegation that they're involved in terrorism. No evidence, no charges, no trial, nothing. And it's extraordinarily dangerous, especially when you consider the fact that when allegations of terrorism by the government are subjected to judicial review, in overwhelmingly high percentages of the cases, 72%, courts find that the allegations are without merit. So who would ever justify allowing the president to target American citizens for assassination without any judicial oversight or charges or due process of any kind?
Do you believe that if this was President George W. Bush, who was widely distrusted and disliked by a huge percentage of the American population by the end of his term, as opposed to the current president, who is laden with lots of hope and aspiration and lots of grand ideas that many people feel he articulates very well, and yet his actions create a massive cognitive dissonance that actually allows him to get away with more than George W. Bush could when it comes to encroachments on civil liberties, facilitating theft from the American people, or potentially calling you or me a terrorist and trying to have us killed?
Well, I know that that's the fact. I mean, the Republicans are at least being consistent. When Bush was president, they said, we think the president should be able to have whatever powers he wants in an unchecked fashion, as long as it's justified by terrorism and war. The Democrats, though, said that they were against those things, that the president shouldn't have powers to exercise in an unchecked fashion. And again, if you look at what Democrats, including Barack Obama, objected to, it was merely things like eavesdropping on Americans and detaining them without due process and without charges. And now Democrats have completely abandoned those objections now that there's a Democrat in the White House, and apparently not just detaining and eavesdropping Americans, but targeting them for murder is acceptable to the Democratic Party now that there's a Democrat in the White House. And again, if you justify that, targeting American citizens for assassination without any due process, what don't you approve of?
Are you surprised at the media's lack of an outroar relative to this when you consider what it might have been if George W. Bush did the exact same thing quickly?
Well, I think the media wasn't really particularly all that upset about what Bush did either. And I think the problem is that if you justify something with the word terrorism, it scares the media, and they're afraid to appear sympathetic to terrorism by opposing it. And what they have to get back to is the basic rights and constitution that say that political leaders in the United States cannot exercise power in an unchecked way.
Glenn, sing it loud, sing it proud. Thank you so much for speaking in public and speaking truth. And again, we invite debate, both myself and Glenn, on any of these issues. We don't try to present it. I don't try to present it. I know Glenn doesn't as point of view, but as point of fact.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My topic for this evening is now it's assassinations. What have we allowed ourselves to become? Are we no longer a nation of laws? Have we become instead a nation of men who make secret arrests? Are secret prisons now simply another tool of the federal government law enforcement? Is secret rendition of individuals now permitted out of misplaced fear? Have we decided that the writ of habeas corpus is not worth defending? Is torture now an acceptable tool for making us safe? Unfortunately, the single answer to all of these questions from the leaders of our country and to many of our citizens appears to be yes. And now we are told that assassination of foreigners as well as American citizens is legitimate and necessary to provide security for our people. It is my firm opinion that nothing could be further from the truth. Secret arrests, secret renditions, torture, and assassinations are illegal under both domestic and international law. These activities should be anathema to the citizens of a constitutional republic. The real threat doesn't arise from our failure to torture, rather desensitizing our nation to the willful neglect and sacrifice of our civil liberties fought and died for over the centuries is the threat. The concept of habeas corpus existed even before King John of England was forced in 1215 by his rebellious barons to sign the Magna Carta. This basic principle and expression of individual liberty, which has survived 800 years, greatly influenced the writing of our Constitution and our common law heritage. Today, we hardly hear a whimper, either from the American people or a stone silent U.S. government as our cherished liberties are eradicated. Instead, we have a government that deliberately orchestrates needless fear and makes people insecure enough to ignore the reality of their lost liberties. The latest outrage is the current administration's acknowledgement that we now have a policy that permits assassination not only of foreign suspects, but of American citizens as well. Of course, the CIA has used secret assassinations in a limited fashion for decades, despite international, domestic, and moral law. When done secretly, as in the past, our government at least recognized that assassination was illegal and wrong. Frighteningly and astonishingly, however, the policy is now explicit. National Intelligence Director Dennis Blair, in open testimony before the House Intelligence Committee on February 3rd of this year, acknowledged that American citizens can indeed be assassinated at our government's discretion. The U.S. government attempted to assassinate Anwar al-Awlaki in Yemen without even charging him with a crime. We're told this evidence is secret, that he does not deserve any constitutional rights, and that some unknown individual in the administration has the authority to declare him a threat, and therefore a legitimate target for assassination. Yes, I know he is probably a very bad person. Yes, I know that only a few Americans are on the assassination hit list. Yes, I know that artificially generated fear makes a large number of Americans inclined to applaud this effort, which supposedly will make us safe. But if this could become standard operating procedure and a permanent precedent is established, let me assure you that this abuse of the law will spread. It's time for Congress and the American people to wake up to the realities of the dangers we face. We must remember as members of Congress that we have taken an oath to protect and defend the Constitution from all enemies, foreign and domestic. It should not be that difficult to distinguish the difference between the danger posed by the underwear bomber and the danger posed by a government that endorses secret prisons, torture, and assassinating American citizens. And I yield back the balance of my time.